Now, the analysis of Shields and Gerson, syndicated columnist Mark Shields, Washington Post columnist Michael Gerson, David Brooks is off tonight. Mark, what do you make of these Rahm Emanuel stories, his pro-Emanuel stories?
Jim, in 45 years in Washington, I've never seen anything like it. I mean, it is inconceivable that a president who's engaged in the biggest fight of his presidency, that is passage of the health care, is the defining issue. The stories are coming out. Rahm Emanuel, according to the reporters, did not talk to the reporters, but the people who did talk to the reporters are known allies and friendly to Rahm Emanuel, that if the president had followed his advice, if he had followed his advice, he'd be better off. Now, substitute Bill Moyers for Lyndon Johnson. And if Lyndon Johnson picked up the paper and read that Bill Moyers was reported in the paper, his press secretary, of having given him best advice, and Lyndon Johnson would be a lot better off politically if he'd followed it, Bill Moyers would be packing that afternoon. He'd be lucky to get out of there with his body intact.
Well, Michael, you have some recent experience in the George W. Bush White House. What do you think would happen if a similar thing happened there?
Well, I have to echo. I've never seen anything like it. I served two chief of staffs, and it's kind of their job to solve problems like this. Sometimes a secretary of the state or whatever goes off the reservation, or there are conflicts. It's their job to be the honest broker and to make things work. In a situation like this, it's hard to imagine Rahm Emanuel now being the honest broker. He's put his views out there. He's and called into question two very important policies. A kind of big bang on health care, saying I would have done something more limited, in the middle of a health care debate. And then also the New York trials for the 9/11 conspirators, saying that he opposed this. And that's a very sensitive issue, too. That's profoundly destructive to the president's agenda. I've never seen anything like it.
You agree it's profoundly destructive to the president?
Well, Jim, how does the president come off? Yeah. The president comes off, in the stories, disengaged, excessively cerebral, not terribly politically strong or decisive. And one of them, the rest of the staff, senior staff, come in for a punch, too. I mean, it's just there's no reading of this that could be helpful. And if it's true that Rahm Emanuel had nothing to do with it, then Rahm Emanuel probably ought to seek a public forum, a friendly forum, and go on and just, you know, blast these stories and say that, you know, Barack Obama is the toughest, most decisive guy, and his decisions have been the right decisions, and I'm there to serve. I mean, because I just think it's unhelpful.
You agree, though? You agree, Michael, that somebody's got to do something about this? It can't go on like this.
Well, I agree with that suggestion. I think that Emanuel himself is going to have to try to get in front of this. I think that it's probably out of the question to have a change in chief of staff in the middle of a healthcare debate. I think that would be very destructive in of itself. But it's hard just to pretend like it didn't happen.
Okay. The point that was made, that John Boehner made in Ray's piece, that you add up the Charlie Rangel situation and the David Patterson thing, and now Congressman Massa's resignation, you got chaos among Democrats. You see chaos?
Not necessarily. I mean, these things aren't unprecedented. I mean, we've seen them before, but it does add to a narrative. Because Democrats were really hit in the health care process for a kind of legal corruption when it came to benefits for Nebraska or benefits for Louisiana. So it kind of adds to a narrative of corruption that I think is destructive for any party in the majority. We saw in 2006 and in 1994 that people usually throw out majority parties when they look arrogant and corrupt. And Republicans have experienced that. And I think that if Democrats don't confront this, they're really kind of sleepwalking into a very serious situation in November.
You see the same?
Yeah, I think each of them is unique. I mean,
sure.
David Patterson is the revenge of Elliot Spitzer. I mean, David Patterson is, I'm sure, a decent man, but he was not equipped to be governor of New York at a very tough time. And that's become obvious.
And Spitzer had to resign.
And he chose him as his running mate.
I mean,
the John Edwards award that goes to John Kerry for 2004 for picking running mates. I mean, it does matter whom you do pick.
Yeah.
But I think that the Patterson thing aside, I mean, Charlie Rangel is a, you know, is an American tragedy. I mean, he's a wonderful, wonderful, beloved figure. But what he has done, I mean, there's the
combat veterans in the Korean War,
high school dropout, and was one of the Buffalo Soldiers. I mean, the Black Regiment in Korea was a Purple Heart and a Bronze Star combat, and came back and finished high school on the GI Bill. Went to college at St. John's and then at NYU and then St. John's Law School. I mean, just a great story of up from the bootstraps and all the rest of it. But the sense of entitlement had set in. I mean, you're talking about $500,000 unreported and in wealth. And so to his credit, he didn't say, I'm doing this because of my health or I'm doing this to clear my family name. He basically stood up there and said, look, I've become a burden to my party and my colleagues and my friends, and I don't want to do that.
Yeah. Michael, the phrase that that Mark used, the sense of entitlement, the idea that you get to a certain place in politics where you're bulletproof, it seems to affect a certain group of people in politics, whether they're from the left or the right or Democrats or Republicans, just goes with it sometimes, doesn't
it? No, it seems that way. We've seen it in other circumstances. I mean, one of the reasons the parties changed in the House in 2006 was the Abramoff scandal and personal scandals that related to Mark Foley. And
these are all Republicans. Right,
exactly. And so you see this in the majority. It seems to be a recurring kind of experience. But it's not a helpful one now, where you both have ideological problems, the Democrats seem to, opposition to the kind of role of government they're proposing, and then you add on top of this a feeling that they're disconnected or corrupt. I mean, that's a serious combination.
What you're reading now about health care reform after the president made his speech on Wednesday, and where things look, where do they look? You think the Congress is going to, in fact, pass these?
Well, what we've seen so far is that there are no people who voted no the first time who are saying, yes, I'm going to vote for it this time, the Senate bill in the House. And there are a few people who voted for it the first time who've said, no, I'm not going to vote for it in the House. Okay, so that's a problem. But I do think that Speaker Pelosi believes that there's an audience here that people that she might be able to persuade. And these are essentially blue dog Democrats who like the Senate approach better than the House approach. You know, it's marginally less expensive. It doesn't have the public option. Okay, she needs to get half a dozen of these people to switch their votes from the first time around opposing to supporting this time. That's not an easy task, but I also don't think it's an impossible task.
What you're reading.
I thought the president in his speech on Wednesday struck the right notes. He is talking, Michael's right, he's talking to Democrats. He's not talking to Republicans, but I thought he drew it quite well. He threw out four Republican ideas, the personal savings accounts that had come up at the summit, the limits on medical malpractice. And I thought it showed that sense of willing to build a coalition, a consensus, to compromise, and knowing full well that he's not going to get any Republican votes, and sort of drawing the lines between the two parties. And I think he did that well. He said he's willing to do anything. He's going to go out and campaign for Ike Skelton in Missouri, who was against the bill, Jason Altmaier in Pennsylvania.
Democrats both.
Both Democrats who were in that group of 38 who opposed it. Yep. But I think it's tough, Jim. I think it's a tough thing. There is great mistrust and distrust on the part of House Democrats toward the United States Senate. There are right now 70 bills sitting in the Senate that passed the House with 50 or more House Republicans voting for them that the Senate hasn't acted on. I mean, and we saw Jim Bunning this week holding up the whole thing, that the place just doesn't, it doesn't function. I mean, it's not dysfunctional, it just doesn't function. And so there's a great skepticism. Are we going to walk out and vote for that Senate bill, which is loaded with problems, not including the Cornhusker, Ben Nelson deal and all the rest of it from Nebraska, and then have it founder in the Senate, and we're stuck out there.
So there are actually some Democrats who want a letter from 51 members of the Senate
that
they will do these things
before they'll do their vote.
Right, exactly. Yeah. Because they deeply distrust that institution.
Michael, do you have an analytical point that you'd like to make about what Jim Bunning did?
My analytical point is, of all the spending you could pick to object to, unemployment spending in the midst of a recession makes very little sense to me. I mean, it's this kind of Republican in a very good, I think, political environment for Republicans who could rescue defeat from the jaws of victory. I think this is a terrible message for the Republican Party to send. It's the right message in one way, in a general way, you know, getting a hold of this deficit problem. But applying it to this problem in particular, I think it makes no sense at all.
He was a gift to the Democrats for the reason that Michael cited. I mean, he put a mean face on the Republican Party for 2 or 3 days. But in addition, he made the case for reconciliation. No wonder you need reconciliation. I mean,
they can't do it.
I mean, you can't do it. You got 51 votes, for goodness sakes. I mean, these people over there they couldn't pass a Mother's Day resolution. And, so in that sense, he made the case there, I think, although I think the case for reconciliation is stronger than it was a week ago.
Same the Republicans, finally, the Texas primary race for Governor Rick Perry defeated Kay Bailey Hutchison. A message there?
Well, certainly a message of anti-Washington. I mean, Rick Perry, now the longest-serving governor in the history of Texas, running as the challenger against Kay Bailey Hutchison, who's been essentially undefeatable for 20 years.
I mean,
she's a state treasurer and the United States senator, and she was put squarely on the defensive about Washington. It tells you where the Texas Republican Party is. I mean, the regular party establishment was very much with Kay Bailey Hutchison.
I'm not sure because, I mean, a race like Florida, the primary, Republican primary, is shaping up as an ideological battle between a conservative and a moderate.
That's Kristen Rubio.
Right, exactly.
Right.
In Texas,
for governor. Yeah.
Right.
I mean, for Senate, I'm sorry.
Right,
yeah.
For the Senate. But in Texas, both of, the basic argument that Hutchison made was, it's my turn. It was not an ideological critique. Much of this was rooted in a personality conflict between two camps of people in Texas that didn't like one another very much. There was a little bit of an ideological overlay. I think, Perry eventually rallied some conservative support against Hutchison.
He did.
But the primary, argument here was a personality argument.
She did not expect Perry to run again.
She thought that he had promised not to, that it was her turn to come back to Texas and do what she wanted to do. But that's not much of a political argument.
So. This is a fellow who had entertained the possibility of secession and made the bogus...
You got a problem with that?
made the bogus claim that it was part of the deal when Texas came into the Union.
Now, that's right.
Just remind Governor
Actually,
Perry,
as
Texas
a matter
did secede from the Union in 1861 and 623,000 Americans died in the conflict that followed.
As a matter of history, when Texas did become a state of the Union, part of it was they reserved the right to divide someday
into
five other countries. I mean, to four other, yeah, right, or whatever, something like that.
Yep.
Thank you very much, both of you.